How can set design in real life be used to enhance a virtual experience? That's the topic of today's episode, so let's get to it. You are listening to the How to Create VR podcast, weekly conversations with VR and AR professional creators, designers, and producers. Hello and welcome to another episode of the How to Create VR podcast, where I speak with professional creators, designers, developers, and producers who work on VR, AR, and MR projects. I'm Marcelo Lewin, an immersive content specialist focused on e-learning and training. I'm also the creator and the guy behind howtocreatevr.com. My guest today is Darragh Dandurand, a multidisciplinary creative and curator with award-winning works in photography, writing, journalism, filmmaking, and emerging media, who's now focused on designing immersive physical sets for mixed reality narrative experiences. Darrah and I will be chatting all about set design in real life and how it affects the VR experience. But before we get started, I want to remind you to register at howtocreatevr.com. It's free and registration gives you access to all of our live events, tutorials, practice assets, podcast interviews, videos, and more. Just visit howtocreatevr.com and click on the register for free button. All right, Darrah, welcome to the podcast.
Hi there. Thank you so much for having me.
I'm glad to have you here. Don't remember how we connected, probably LinkedIn or one of the social networks got us together, as people get together today now. And we chatted about set design, real life set design, and how that affects VR. And I was very intrigued by that. So that's what we're going to be talking about today. But before we jump in, why don't you give us a little bit about your background?
Sure, absolutely. My background makes me one of those people that are involved in mixed reality and VR today, sort of coming from the fringes of other industries. I identify closely with having worked in the film industry and quite a bit in photography and journalism. I started first as a video editor several years ago and just love telling short form stories, which is very relevant right now for VR narratives, and gradually transitioned into journalism. And from there, jumping around in terms of telling different stories and different types of media. And that sort of bleeds into how I wound up in VR, where I was pulled in because there were a bunch of experiences and skills I had in other spaces and other industries that made a lot of sense for where VR is now. And it's exciting because that means that VR is becoming more mainstream. If people like myself, coming from other disciplines, are getting really excited to join in on the fun.
I agree. It definitely is becoming more mainstream. I can see a time when you go to a movie and there'll be like a whole VR experience that kind of gets you into the movie before you even go watch a movie.
Absolutely. And that's why I think I'm drawn to the narrative side of VR. There's so much potential in these other parts of the industry and just across mixed reality in general. But I love the narrative side of things because I just see it as wholly compelling. I mean, it's the next level of storytelling, kind of how I think of other forms of media. I'll reference them quickly. Filmmaking would be one, definitely. Architecture, another, where you have all these other different types of media blending together, whether it's physics or it's writing or it's painting or it's structure. And you have to combine with expertise all of these other moving pieces to get something that people just lose themselves in. And it's a really magical recipe that stands out among other types of media.
Yeah, definitely. What's your favorite VR experience as of today that you've tried, and what makes it your favorite?
Thanks for asking. I have a smile on my face because the first thing I want to mention is Tilt Brush, actually, which probably is no surprise to you given that it is a tool for so many people. I cried the first time I went in Tilt Brush. A friend put me in the headset and he had these bright gleaming eyes when he said, "Oh my God, you've never done Tilt Brush before." And this was a while ago. And I said, "No, but I've heard of it." And he just lit up and said, "I would love to put you into the headset for the first time." And it was a very emotional experience for me. And I think a lot of people feel that way about Tilt Brush. It was so beautiful and it was everything I wanted it to be in that moment. It just made my visions and my ideas of stepping into space, especially working with 3D space, working with physical space, so much more vivid. So I love Tilt Brush. I think it's a great product. I wish it got more love. It's incredible. On that note, actually, I was at a VR bar the other day here in New York City visiting the owner named Kishore, and I brought along a friend of mine who had never been in VR, and we put her into Tilt Brush first. And his rationale was similar to how I felt about it, which was get someone in to see the true magic. Let them create first. They can play the games anytime, but Tilt Brush really brings the, not only the novelty, but the power of VR directly to your hands.
Did you get it right away, the 3D aspect of it, or were you painting like flat Photoshop and then you realize, wait, I can actually paint all around me and walk around it? Because that was my first experience. I thought it was cool, but I realized that I was just drawing flat in front of me. And then I realized, like, wait a minute, this is VR. I can draw all around me. I can walk around it. I can do all these things that I can't normally do. So it took me a little while to grasp that idea.
I think the first time that I went in, because I knew what it was, I'd heard of Tilt Brush and I'd watched videos of Tilt Brush. And if I'm remembering correctly, when I first went in, I think I drew like two lines in front of me that were as if it was a 2D plane, like a large canvas. And then immediately I started spinning around and creating basically like this neon igloo just because I could. And I was jumping through it and I was just so excited. And then for a solid week, this was in a studio that I was working in San Francisco. I think that I was in Tilt Brush every night, like late at night for 2 hours, just making stuff. And I would get so tired, I would start sitting on the floor and scale the piece down. So it was at my height and my size when I just got sleepy and I'd kneel there and paint it. But it was just magic. That's coming from an interactive sort of, not productivity tool, but creation tool. On the flip side, which is directly connected to narrative storytelling, I'm still in love with one of the first experiences that I saw at a festival, which was called Battlescar, is called Battlescar. I'm sure you've seen it. It's award-winning. It's beautiful. It's a collaboration from multiple production companies and creatives. It's short form, which makes me love it even more. When I've worked in the past on different films and commercials, I've always really appreciated short form. I've always loved music videos. And Battlescar is this ode to punk music. It's a dedication to New York City. And it's a love story that's sort of hinted at between two women running around the Lower East Side in the 1980s or 90s, discovering music for themselves. And it's so well stylized. I've probably done it now 6 or 7 times. And every time I stand in a different location or at a different height so that I can see all the detail work that the visual artist put in, it's amazing. It's not really interactive at all. I think at one point they might use some head positioning, but you can't really interact with any of the characters or any of the elements. But it's stunning. It's a great narrative.
I have not checked it out. I have heard of it, and I'm definitely going to check it out now that you recommended it. Well, let's define set design regardless of VR or in real life.
Well, a broader term for set design is really scenic design, which sort of encompasses multiple kinds of production from theater and film, art direction in general, stylizing something. Now it's also incorporating immersive staging, which would be leaning towards VR or things like Sleep No More, which is immersive theater. So I think that as a broader industry, it's everything from considering the implication and mood of lighting to actually physically constructing passageways or creating lighting and staging schematics. It sort of runs the gamut.
So how does that differ, let's say, from traditional film and TV for VR, set design itself? And just to clarify, when we're talking about set design so people aren't confused, we're talking about external set designs that bring you into the experience of VR, not internal VR set design, which is a totally different conversation for a different episode we'll do one day. But how does that differ, the what we're calling IRL set design for VR, from TV and film?
I'm also going to start calling it IRL because I think it is catchy, and credit to you that you're covering this topic, because physical set design, what we're discussing today, is becoming a standard for narrative experiences across the board at film festivals. Film festivals are now really seeming to only accept VR experiences showing if they come with a set design, like fully conceived before they get there, normally fully fabricated, which shouldn't intimidate narrative designers and creators for VR, but should encourage them to really think outside the box. They already are in that mindset. And that's all sort of connected because people aren't really formally talking about this. I have very few references I can think of in terms of articles or podcasts or interviews that people are discussing the significance of why set design is important. But how does it differ? I would say in its use and purpose. When you go to see, say, like a theater production, you are in the seats, you are staring up at the stage, and you're appreciating that the actors are moving through it, that the crew is behind it, manipulating different elements like the lighting, like props. But when you are participating, whether you're in a VR headset or let's say augmented reality headset, and you are moving through a space in order to experience this narrative, you as a set designer have to be so conscious about not only the up close and personal, but the integrity of how something is built for safety. That's going to come up later. I have a note I want to make about safety in VR set design, but a whole other number of things, including how are people interacting in this space? Are there physical elements that they can touch that will directly be tracked or mapped in the headset? Are they supposed to be playfully exploring the space first before the VR headset ever comes on? It's a variety of things, but you have to look at the stage as just as much a player in getting those people to suspend their disbelief as what is actually in the headset as well.
I guess if you have a set design for a movie, which is very passive, I mean, you're enjoying that design and you're looking at it, but then you go watch a movie. Whereas in VR, you're going to be playing in that set itself, right? So there's major considerations, as like you mentioned, to think about such as safety, which we're going to touch upon in a minute. But you talk about immersive experiences, which involve both virtual reality and augmented reality. But there is a huge difference beyond what we understand between VR and AR, but from a set perspective, right? Because one, with VR, once you put on your HMD, the set is gone, at least the physical view of it. Maybe you still can interact with it by touching it, but the physical view of it is gone. But in AR, the set is still there. So what are some considerations when you're designing an IRL set for VR versus AR?
Well, you nailed it when you said that there's still an element that lasts and lingers in terms of physical touch. And maybe even other senses can play in here too when you're designing for an immersive set for VR. So you can sort of experiment with however many haptics you want. I've gone through several experiences, say The Void is well known. There are quite a few award-winning pieces that use haptics while you're in your HMD. And it really captures you because, again, it's all about suspending that disbelief for as long as possible. So you're sort of holding on to not only transitioning people into a world from physical into digital, but then from there, keeping them in that world through a whole variety of building techniques, construction techniques. The difference between VR and AR, I mean, besides some of the obvious elements, you can have overlap. Certainly, you should be just as diligent in creating a physical space that is convincing for the narrative or is tied to the narrative and is not only engaging to a participant to check out what your experience is, say you're in a giant convention hall with a bunch of other experiences too, but should get them to see that there's relevance to why you constructed it in this way, both to the narrative as well as benefiting the hardware. When it comes to AR, though, there's endless potential for other more imaginative ways that you can use the headset since you can still see the space that you're in. And that could be using some type of, you know, wallpaper that you can activate. That could be creating little narratives within a space that maybe your participants are waiting in line and they never imagined that they could interact with your narrative already building up to the initial experience. Later on, the big thing I would say, the big difference is that safety component that I mentioned before. When you're in headset in VR, you really need to be, we all know, babysat essentially. And you want to make sure your participants have a wonderful, fun time without being hurt. So in doing that, considering everything from what I call baby proofing, pointy edges and ways in which they could trip over themselves, but also maybe blending textures with the walls that you've created as an example that would match up with what is in the headset. You want to make sure that people can move freely through the space, but have purpose and reason of why they're putting that headset on.
So I would imagine that when you're working on a set design for AR versus VR, you're probably working more closely with the developers of the experience because I mean, I know with VR, you probably have to do that as well. But with VR, you can work independently where, you know, you get the idea, you get the vision, and then you just design it so it ties in with once they're in. But with the AR experience, like you said, you got to match the entire experience throughout from beginning to end. So that means you've got to be on that experience constantly going back and forth to make sure things match and they tie together, right? So does that mean that AR set design is a bit more challenging than VR?
That's a great point you bring up. What stage do you bring on a set designer as a creator? Yeah, for VR, you could bring someone in at the tail end of production or even when they're going into post-production with shipping, especially if the experience is going to be played at consumer level at home and then say you're doing it at a festival. Like a project that I was recently on called Where Thoughts Go, we took the set design based on several elements of the actual VR piece. And thought, okay, how do we sort of ambiguously blend this together to create something that's not only attractive physically, but would be relevant to the piece? And that process really happened in post-production right around shipping. I'm working on a couple AR pieces right now. And as a set designer and creative director, I am intimately involved in pre-production, you know, before a lot of other elements are written, because they have to be married. They have to be... Actually, I have my hands interlocked right now as I'm talking. It has to be a very clear and concerted, communicated effort between the parties that be to make sure that whatever you're designing for AR is consistent throughout. And when one thing changes on the development of the AR piece, it's going to ripple down and affect the set design. So sure, that's a huge component. And I think you bring up a great point that if someone is planning to bring on a set designer, which as I mentioned, is becoming more crucial for exhibited pieces and curated pieces, it's a slightly different timeline.
Definitely. By the way, Where Thoughts Go, fantastic experience. I have it on my Oculus Rift and I love it. Highly recommend everybody try it out. So what kind of tools do you use to design your set? I mean, are these traditional tools that you would use even for filmmaking, or are they specific tools that you're using?
So it runs the gamut from, I will mess around with stuff and say like Tilt Brush and Google Blocks to see what, you know, almost rudimentary, you know, what would this look like? What if I had a canopy here? And I just kind of do a rough sketch. And that's helpful because if I'm working with a VR creator, I can have them pop in and go, okay, you know, this is more like a blueprint, but this is what I'm thinking. And this is the size. Oh, you know what? We can scale it down. Does this look a little bit better, smaller, larger, etc.? I also go straight back to old school because I can paint and sketch and I will just do that on paper. And it's kind of fun to lay something out and be like, okay, would these colors work together? I also work as a fashion photographer, so I'll take time to do mood boards and sort of lay out what I'm feeling and thinking and just create several decks. And I think it's important to say that because I notice, I was actually in a conversation last night with a bunch of women that work in media, and we were talking about how to communicate information. And I think it's important to be transparent and share how you organize your ideas. So it really goes everything from creativity tools in VR to straight up painting on an easel and creating decks in Google Drive. And lastly, I started studying engineering several years ago, and I'll go in and use AutoCAD and I'll use different blueprinting and construction and building programs and sort of just lay out from there and then get real measurements that I can then send off in case I need to use a slightly larger team or I have to fabricate something, etc.
So pretty much the traditional tools that you can use for any kind of media.
Yeah.
I want to circle back for a minute to pre-production. And I know with VR, we said you can come in way after, even during post. But to bring people into the VR experience, there should be a story before they even go in there. So is that story written after, like after post, or is that story really part of the pre-production process? And I'm sure most people don't even think about that when they're creating a VR experience, to write a story before they even get into the headset. So do you find from your experience that people are thinking about this and writing it prior to post-production, or do they wait all the way till the end and go, oh, you know what? We should create a nice set design to bring people into this.
Well, if I may be so bold to say that a lot of our colleagues that work in mixed reality are really focused on what's in the headset and not what's outside of it, which I get. I get when your world is on the computer, when you are programming and developing, especially for digital content within this universe that exists inside an HMD, of course you're going to be, you know, that's where your attention is. So my ask would be that narrative creators start really thinking outside the box and engaging these conversations much earlier. When it comes to where a set designer would step in, especially say for VR, yeah, you could bring them on in post. And in which case, you know, similar to experiences I have had, I'll be called up, asked to go through the experience in VR, give general notes on set design, and then sort of create something in line with what the narrative is. But I think that the standard is just increasing tenfold every film festival. From what I know, from what I've seen, what I'm hearing, people are just wanting to push the boundaries of presentation and exhibition. So if you are starting to develop for narratives, and if you're not necessarily even new to this, start rethinking when you engage that conversation. Maybe it isn't the start of when you start writing the experiences. For AR it is, but for VR, you can wait just a little bit until you flesh out some details. And I would say get that VR set designer, the immersive set designer, engaged in the production process, because then they can weigh in and go, oh, if you can do X, Y, and Z in the headset, I can match that up here and make it more inviting for whatever reason with the physical design. To touch on another point that you had about the purpose of narrative design in terms of writing, I know there's a lot of overlap with different words, but to define that a little bit more, you don't necessarily have to have a rationale for putting the headset on, except that the experience looks engaging and that the set drew you to it. Because let's be honest, if you don't put a VR headset on, or an AR headset for that matter, it's just normally a laptop, HMD, and some sensors sitting on a table, and it's kind of boring. So that set design serves the purpose of being what I consider the lamp that the moths flock to, especially at conventions and especially at festivals. You need something that draws people to it. That's why the physical set is so crucial. People want to know what you're working on. They want to come to it. Why not give them an excuse to do that?
I just have a couple of thoughts on everything you said, because prior to meeting you, I'll be honest with you, I never thought about what happens outside. To me, it's always been about the experience inside. But after speaking with you, and the more I think about it, part of the problem with virtual reality is convincing people to get into it. Once they're in, it's over. They get it, they love it, and they become huge fans of it. But getting them to go from real life to VR is the part that everybody's having problems convincing people to do. I so agree with you now, and I totally understand what you mean by set design really sucking people into that experience, right? Because that's the first thing they see. And you're right. Every convention you go to, everything I've done actually, where I presented, it's been a table with a laptop, cables everywhere, and, you know, cameras or whatever you need to set it all up. And it's super boring. You got to go, hey, you want to try this? Come on, try it. You're going to love it. Once they're in, they love it. So I totally understand the vision of set design and why it's truly important. And I would argue it's important not just in narrative and, of course, gaming, but also in other use cases, for example, in training. There's nothing to say that if you're going to be training somebody how to, let's say, drive a car or fly a plane, that you wouldn't create a set design that is like a plane, basically.
You are absolutely right. And it's great to hear that you are seeing the importance of this physical IRL set design. I have a big smile on my face right now. I wish that I could talk to every narrative creator, whether they're new at the biz or been in it for a while, maybe in other industries, and help them imagine a set, because you don't want to sacrifice an incredible experience in the headset with an extremely boring physical setup. And I have now tried so many VR experiences, kind of also on the spectrum from trainings and more B2B, and then all the way to narrative and, you know, film festival stuff, where you go into someone's studio or you do a site visit at somebody's office as they're working on production. And it's incredible. The piece is incredible. And it's acceptable when you're having this kind of casual encounter with it. But then if you go to a festival, or you go to a convention or a conference, those demos, at least for me, and I think other people that have come from other industries like myself, we see the beauty of the potential. We see all the ways in which you can engage further, because the what I'm calling the mainstream problem, which so many of us are trying to figure out, and we all have different puzzle pieces to solve it, is really, among a few other things, the issue with getting people to really love and understand what mixed reality can do for them, And a piece of that is creating a much more pleasing physical transition. And kind of tying this back to a question you had a few minutes ago, you don't necessarily need a reason for your headset to go on within the physical set transition to digital. But so many creatives, especially people coming from theater, shout out to the theater kids, are realizing that if you can give them a narrative plot point to put the headset on, whether it's a crown because you're becoming royalty, or it's because one of the character urges you to see from their perspective with an immersive script being involved, whatever it is, or you're asked to try on some outfit and the HMD is part of that, and in countless other reasons, it makes it more magical and it gives you purpose. And if you feel a purpose-driven connection to a piece of technology, it becomes part of your life in a way that's seamless instead of belabored.
It's funny because I was actually going to ask you, how do you incorporate HMD into the set design? So it's part of the story, and you obviously answered it, but I want to go beyond that. You mentioned about we have to babysit people, obviously, because you don't want it to trip over cables or run into walls or all that. And I know this isn't really part of set design, but it could be. But how do you incorporate the actors or the person babysitting the participant to be part of the set and to be part of the story? So now it's no longer a person that is babysitting you and giving you an HMD. It's the king's helper providing you with the crown or whatever.
So I have a couple examples. One, haunted houses, if I may be a little cheesy. Haunted houses are taking advantage of VR left and right. You can imagine. VR can be very emotionally overwhelming. I'm not a big fan of haunted houses. I'm a little bit of a scaredy cat, but that hasn't stopped me from trying out things professionally and going through experiences because I want to see how they're done on a technical level. And there's a haunted house that a few of my friends told me about in Los Angeles. And essentially go into an electric chair and they'll put a headset on you, a mad scientist, and you would see yourself getting operated on, your brain getting operated on.
I have to try that. You have to tell me where that is because I have to go.
I have to ask them for the reference. I don't know if they're still doing it. They did it last year.
Sounds amazing.
But if you think about it, you have these actors that go into this experience with you and they're crazy scientists, essentially, or like prison guards. And they'll strap you into an electric chair and they'll put this headset on you. And then in VR, because they're all in costume, you can see them sort of moving around you, I guess. And why is that significant? It's because you're getting all of the scare and the shock factor of being in VR. But then additionally, you are still having someone in that room with you who's playing a bit part, but is looking out for not only you being scared and you needing to tap out like normal actors would do at any other haunted house. Those actors are trained to step in and intervene, even if it seems like they're there to chase you with a chainsaw. And it's also great because they're letting you believe their role. But at all times, especially when you have a headset on, they can sort of stand back for a moment, check the climate of the room. If everyone's screaming without totally losing it, then you're in good shape. But I think that that's sort of going to be a new responsibility for actors that are looking to do immersive theater moving forward. You have actors, not of the past, certainly this is still relevant in acting, whether it's theater or film, their goal is to embody that character and make you believe so deeply that that's who they are. You're tasking actors now with a totally new responsibility to not only embrace their character, but up close and personal with the element of potential touch from an audience member, which is a whole other conversation. And on top of that, also be trained to recognize when they need to step in on a very human level.
And to improvise as well, as things happened. There's a lot more responsibilities. I just had a great conversation with the lead actress of The Invisible Hours VR experience, and we spoke about all the new responsibilities that an actor now has to take on. So definitely if you or the audience listening wants to learn more about that, check out that podcast, because it's really interesting about all these responsibilities that actors now have in immersive experiences that they never had before.
Not to go too far down this road in conversation, but I think that actors are such an important piece of a lot of immersive narrative experiences. Not all, but some. I'm not saying you need actors in all of your set designs. That's not necessary. But to be an immersive actor, or I should say immersive narrative actor, is really an interesting role because that sort of encompasses everything from motion capture to being the one that gets you in a headset when you're waiting in line for whatever immersive experience you're about to go into. I have another example that I think is worth bringing up, which I found charming and really well done, especially because I found out that they executed it on a really short timeline, to my understanding. So shout out to Meow Wolf, who I love a lot. I kind of proposed to the company on Twitter a few weeks ago. I was just like, please, can I marry the whole company? You guys are amazing. Meow Wolf is awesome. And they teamed up with Magic Leap for LeapCon this past fall, which I had a pleasure to attend. It was an awesome conference. And Meow Wolf had an installation there. I can't remember the name of it, but essentially you were wearing the ML1, of course, and you're sitting on this giant robot thing that was supposed to be frozen on a planet where it had crashed. And your job was to steer this frozen piece of machinery back home through the stars. And you wait in line in this darkened room. It was beautifully lit, like all of Meow Wolf's stuff. It was really, you know, hyper attention to detail on fabricating this physical structure that you're supposed to sit on. And you get onto the piece, you climb up onto it, and this guy dressed in bright pink overalls jumps onto the back of it, sort of standing there while you're sitting on the front holding this steering wheel. And he says, okay, you ready? We have to power this thing up and get it shooting through space all over again. And I looked at him and I realized that he was going to be moving me through the experience on a technical level while using a narrative to convince me of what I had to do. And he was an actor, but he was also a docent. It was interesting to figure it out because with the magic of augmented reality, I didn't have a real functional steering wheel in front of me. Instead, I had this sort of touchpad that would only light up in the headset. You know, that was the other cool thing about physical set design. None of this piece needed to be wired. There were really no mechanics to this piece except for a couple vibration haptics as you were flying through space. And then with the ML1, it was perfectly mapped inside of the windshield of this physical machinery. And you could look at it and you would see yourself shooting through space, first person perspective. And you'd look back down at your dashboard and you could see all the controls lighting up in the headset. And he would get you through each experience. And how cool is this? Was trained to listen to the audio cues from soaring through space and the different noises the buttons would make, and he would know that would cue the next round of dialogue.
Interesting.
How to use the mapping that you were seeing in AR. The point is, there's infinite potential on how to engage your actors, on how to engage your docents, your participants, your technology, the physical, the digital. The realm has no boundaries.
That reminded me of an experience that is being used in the medical industry, specifically for drawing blood from kids, where they put kids in this VR experience that has a little bit of set design, but when they're about to draw the blood, right, pinch them with the needle, there's a cue in the experience that matches something that's happening in the narrative. So when they're in there and they're about to get the needle in the arm, something happens in the experience, and instead of them crying, they actually laugh or whatever the story tells them, right? Gives them the experience about. So that way the kids aren't like hysterical about getting their blood drawn. And they're using that kind of what you just described, that mixture of VR and real life to make them be more at ease when their blood is being drawn. So again, that's another example of going beyond narrative and gaming, right? Where you can use it for other kinds of use cases.
Absolutely. That's a great one to bring up that's outside of, it is narrative, but I know what you're talking about. And to serve a purpose that is wholly convincing and actually is beneficial in a lot of ways to letting you do your job on the outside of the headset and making sure that your patient feels taken care of emotionally while they're inside.
Well, Darragh, we're almost out of time here. I do want to ask you, I have 100 more questions to ask you, but we'll leave it for part two. The last one I do want to ask about is design safety, right? Because that's a big deal. You don't want people running into the set, tripping, hurting themselves. And we've all seen the YouTube videos, right, of people in VR and falling and all sorts of stuff. So what are some design considerations when you're putting together a set to make sure that it is safe?
Thanks for asking. And this topic is near and dear to me because I said earlier that there's such potential for beauty and the beauty of potential that exists within mixed reality. And you don't want your participants, many of whom I think for a lot of us are going into VR with our experience for the first time, to have a negative memory of that. So safety is, you know, first and foremost. I would say standard, the shock value. I'm not talking about something that's scary, but helping lead someone into an experience, help them understand the tools they have, help them understand that they can always opt out. Having autonomy and agency is directly related to feeling safe. So really communicating that. Sometimes you want people to be wholly invested emotionally in your experience, but you never want them to feel like they are trapped in it. So communicating that is directly related to safety. Two, I think if you are using docents, say you're going to a festival or a convention and you are either leading someone through or now you have a docent or a volunteer helping you, make sure that they know that they also have the agency to step in, not touching people suddenly. You know, consent's always important, even if you feel like that might take them out of the moment of VR. It won't. It'll just make them feel respected. And then when it comes to other physical elements of design, because those are related, that sharp edges thing, maybe you don't go for super pointy. Make sure that your cables are all taped down. Have your docent or be walking around with someone, you know, if you have an untethered bag or something, make sure you're holding onto those cables and that there's nothing like chairs or poles that it can wrap around. Something that we talked about on our initial phone call, what happens if you have an interactive experience where one of your participants can reach out in VR and touch something and they punch a wall? I've looked into that by either having extremely soft padding, make your walls breakable, that if something like that were to happen, you'd rather sacrifice the build and the construction than the person. So look into those things as well. I've dealt now with several fire marshals, nothing bad, but pro tip, you want to check the fire codes of any of the exhibition spaces that you're looking into, because you don't want your beautiful set to get torn down anywhere, because different states have different fire codes. And say California, where I've done a lot of my work, is very strict about what type of textures and materials they'll let into convention halls or exhibition spaces. That's a huge one. Make sure you coordinate with people on that. The other thing about safety is if you're doing some space that has a type of enclosure, that means three or more walls and a roof. You have to make sure you build it out that if someone either panics or there's a mechanical failure or something like that, they can escape it very quickly. So consider not bottlenecking people, like creating a long hallway where people can't get out. Safety definitely comes into that as well. And I would say, two, is portability. So I spent a good part of 2018 building countless blanket forts, like childhood blanket forts, these big structures that were very whimsical and magical throughout the Americas, and had a really good time doing it. But one thing that I would realize as I was building it was that people want to feel safe and enclosed. And for our experience, that was very appropriate for this very intimate, nostalgic feel for where thoughts go. But at the same time, you had to make sure that there was an element of, say, privacy. So consider what your participants are emotionally going to feel as you build it. You don't necessarily have to make sure that the whole world can see them in VR when they're in VR. Really play into the purpose of why you're creating a set and why you're even creating your VR experience in the first place, and then make sure that the set has purpose and reason for its construction. So that's a bunch of tips, but I feel like they're all connected to the emotional well-being, safety, and physical agency that our participants need to love VR.
Well, all those are great tips. And Darragh, you're a wonderful person. I'm so happy I got to meet you and I got you on the podcast to talk about all this stuff today. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much. I'm so flattered. I really like the stuff that you guys are doing because I think that it's very niche and there are not a lot of other people talking about the topics you're covering. So thank you for prioritizing this one. I think that there'll be more people stepping into this space in the months and years to come.
I agree. Now, if people want to get a hold of you, do you want to give an email, Twitter, whatever you like?
Sure. My email is my first and last name, which is very complicated. darraghdandurand@gmail.com. Darragh Dandurand. My website is darrahdandurand.com, and my Twitter handle is at Darrah Dandy, DarrahDandy, because my name is too damn long for Twitter.
I know exactly. Well, thank you again, Darrah. I really appreciate it. And to the rest of you, I'm glad you were here with us. Just a quick reminder, if you want to access all of our live events, tutorials, practice assets, podcast interviews, videos, and more, register for free at howtocreatevr.com. Finally, if you want to attend our live events in virtual reality, join us inside Altspace VR. Just visit howtocreatevr.com/Altspace VR and subscribe to our channel. So until the next episode, I'm Marcelo Lewin. Cheers, everyone.